claimed another high-profile victim, this time Bendigo's Girton College. The Anglican-owned school, which has debts believed to be around $8 million, will close its doors at the end of the year, leaving 450 students and 50 teachers to make alternative arrangements.
I arrived at Girton in 1988, and it was a thriving school. The school had a lot of boarders. It was a very diverse group of students, and that was part of its charm. The diocese, Anglican Diocese, had decided to expand the school, and then, of course, a number of factors came into play. It had been a global recession. There were huge unemployment, rising interest rates. You had parents who couldn't afford fees, falling enrolments. The school lost 170 students in 2 years, and that becomes unsustainable, particularly when the diocese was, like everywhere else, confronting rising interest rates. And they had gone into a lot of debt, no doubt, to build a very beautiful campus and facilities. And unfortunately, the timing perhaps wasn't right.
Students at the private school were told last night of the impending closure, trying to come to terms with the announcement.
Upset. Everybody's shocked and upset about everything.
Crying, people.
The year 11s are really upset. They don't know what to do.
I think we were literally sitting together on the day, and it was traumatic being told your school's closing. When you're in year 11, middle of VCE, we were all really very, very upset.
Lots of confusion, I guess, and panic about what we're going to do the following year.
It was our school community that was going to disappear.
Mm.
So it's pretty devastating.
Mm.
The shock decision to close one of Bendigo's oldest and most historic schools stunned the city when it was announced.
We had no inkling of this at all. I happened to be on the council of Girton College. We were called to a meeting on the 13th of August, 92. We tried to have a discussion about changing such a decision, but basically we got nowhere. Our initial reaction was to try and save Girton College. And we spent hours ringing around because we didn't want the parent body to read about this decision in the paper the next day. No, the diocese wasn't interested. We then started, within 24 hours, we called a meeting, a public meeting, and we had over 500 people at that public meeting.
Good evening. Parents and friends at Bendigo's Girton College have launched an ambitious rescue plan to save the school from closure. Faced with a debt believed to be $8 million and falling enrolments, the Save Girton Committee says it has a fortnight to find a solution.
Everybody was devastated. The entire community was devastated. Your school and everything around your life was going to be changed forever. We asked the school if we could have an office in the school to start looking into what we could do to help. That lasted about 2 days, and then the headmaster at the time threw us out.
Parents and friends of Girton wasted no time in leaping to the century-old school's rescue. Following an overwhelming show of support for the college at a crisis meeting on Monday night, a Save Girton office opened today in the Sandhurst Trustees Building in View Street.
We had nothing, absolutely nothing. Before we left the school, Shane Brennan walked up to us one day and said, you know, I can help. He had 3 kids at the school. He said, I can help, I can write. Everything we wanted to do, he wrote.
I will.
And that's how it started.
We had meetings after meetings after meetings. And the passion was just incredible.
Enthusiasm of parents and other groups in the school community is just unbelievable.
And that then became Friends of Girton.
With offers of help for the beleaguered school already pouring in,
the school community meets again tonight to elect a steering committee and begin the long fight back.
I had an accounting practice in the town at the time, and my business partner also had children at the school. So we attended the first meeting when they were calling for nomination. A voice from the back said, I want to put up Richard Trigg's name. So they wrote that down. John Higgs was very clever in the way he formulated that inner group. We all had our particular skills and they were all used to the fullest.
I was the head of boarding at the time. The big family of kids, my own family was in the boarding house as well. I had to make a decision, stay, go, fight, all of those sorts of things at the same time. To find a school in the period of time that we had available was almost impossible.
The Friends of Girton are working around the clock to save the school and are confident of making an offer to the church within a week. Already the promise of cheaper fees is reaping dividends. They still don't know exactly how much money they'll need to raise to buy Girton from the Anglican Church, but say they're confident of reaching their multi-million dollar target.
I do believe in miracles. And yes, I think they have a chance. Oh, again, the church is perfectly happy to cooperate wherever possible and to negotiate.
From that point on, there was pretty much frantic activity. There was negotiations with the diocese. The emphasis was to try and purchase the existing campus. But when we looked at the bank accounts that was available to us, there was $4,000 in it, and at one point we made an offer of $4.1 million to the diocese.
The latest offer to reopen Girton as an independent school has been described by the church as not much better than the first. It's believed to be less than half the school's $9 million debt.
Things started to not pan out, perhaps the way everyone thought would. And we thought, oh, well, we can try. But the diocese was negotiating at that time with the state government to sell the campus. And my godfather.
The Friends of Girton say they'll now enter a third stage of negotiations and claim today's announcement comes as no surprise. The church has initiated discussions with several interested parties. The state government is likely to consider the site for use as Bendigo's second VCE provider. Girton Grammar representatives presented a submission arguing against the viability of the current Girton site as a VCE campus. That would leave the way open for the group to use the Crook Street School sometime in the future. But the plan is in direct opposition to the Anglican churches, which wants to sell the school to the government when it closes later this year. Girton Grammar Chairman John Higgs says his group acted entirely properly. Bishop Ben Wright thinks otherwise.
I see it very much as a sort of an act of piracy. It certainly showed certain ethical standards which aren't in keeping with the ones that we've tried to keep over all of this conflict.
Today, he cut all ties.
I feel that I can't have any more dealings with people who would act in such a way that I would consider very underhanded.
Good things in life never come easy. I see this, so we're just perhaps off the rail at the moment, and what's very important is that we all get back together again, start talking around the table again.
But that's highly unlikely. Bishop Wright effectively withdrawing church support for the school, though that still has to be ratified by the church board. He also questioned the new school's right to use the Girton name and has even reversed a decision to let the school use the Girton badge.
I think the Girton is worn by too many great people. The badge has been worn by too many great people to see it demeaned by a group that would act like this.
Bang. People were arguing with you and fighting with you the whole time. Ooh, because it was, I'm going to get a bit upset talking about it, because it was hard, it was really tough. At every stage we were disappointed, but we were never going to let the disappointment change us. There were about 50 people called the Friends of Girton who did everything in the background, and I mean everything. Every day, had flowers on your desk, cards of thanks on your desk, making you feel special every day. With not one complaint, they held the whole thing together. It was them that put the glue in behind all of this.
We had to move on and create something that that Bendigo needed. Just about everything had to be established again. We were assisted in, you know, by all sorts of organisations around the town, and we needed that support in the background, and that was forthcoming in spades.
Most of us had businesses or jobs, and a lot of those were under a bit of pressure from bosses or co-workers because of the time we were putting into Girton. You know, after work, 4 or 5 o'clock in the evening through to 2 or 3 a.m. Going home for a few hours sleep and then back to our workplaces until 5 o'clock the next day. And that went on for months and months. Each of us were doing our jobs and we were strategising how we could bring it about. And our good friends at Skeggs Redlands came down to help us. They looked over Bendigo and eventually said, you've got it all wrong. You need to be looking at where you started from and rebuild your base again. So we look back at Mackenzie Street, which was owned by Peter Wade at the time. Interestingly, Peter Wade said to us, when Girton moved out of here, I bought this school, and somehow or other God spoke to me and said, Peter, hang on to this school because someone will need it one day. He had a vision and we had a vision, and he said, you've come and I'll deliver. So he gave us a lease on the old campus. And it was just like stepping back in time.
Peter Wade was quite a character. At one stage I said, Peter, I said, we need keys to the rooms. He actually handed me a bucket, a full-size bucket full of keys. They'll open all the doors in the place. I said, thanks, Pete. Naturally, one of the first jobs we had to do was replace all the locks. It was basically left there for 3 or 4 years, and a lot had to be done in a very short time. Probably 2/3 of the rooms in the school were repainted, recarpeted, light fittings fixed, and plumbing issues. There was a lot of glazing. It had deteriorated quite a lot. 99% of the work done in those 2.5 months to get the campus habitable was done by the friends of Girton, the staff, the parents all pitched in. The main reason was we didn't have any money to pay anybody to do anything else. Whenever I sent the message round, they'd roll up and get stuck into it. People that were painting things, they'd never painted something in their lives. And, you know, we had parents turn up with their little kids, you know, just to help, you know, in doing the gardening and stuff. It was it was amazing. That was typical of the situation. We had to get the existing Mackenzie Street campus into a state that the school could be registered. The Registered Schools Board had a strict guidelines as to what was required. At the same time, of course, in the background, running concurrently, was the efforts to get permission to run a school.
To set up a new school, there's a thing called the New Schools Policy. The New Schools Policy took 2 years to get through. We had 3 months to open another school. Good luck with that. They said it's never been done. No, you can't do it. So we said, well, what can we do? Anyway, we went back about 5 times and we eventually got that policy changed. We had to find out all of this on the run. We didn't know anything about it. So
we had to prove that we could teach. So we had to have a curriculum. Of course, having no resources, we were able to, with the support of all the staff at Girton College, photocopy the Girton College curriculum material. The front page would be changed to be a Girton Grammar School front page, and the curriculum of Girton College became the curriculum of Girton Grammar School. But that took the support of all staff, given the administration of Girton College were not supportive at all of the new school.
The end of that year, we had the speech night for the school, and the students at the school were told they weren't allowed to sing the school song. And that's horrendous to tell 16 and 17-year-olds, you know, you've been at the school for 13 years and you can't sing your school song. They'd been absolutely yelled at by the headmaster, you know, you do not walk out there, you do not sing the school song. Well, they belted it out.
They all stomped, and you had this whole hall shaking. It really said, we're not finished.
The community act of defiance and fight really hit its straps.
We would also be looking at ways to reduce the fee level structure so that the school is immediately more available for more members of the community.
We were not setting up an elitist school. We were wanting to have a school that people across society could enrol their children. But we needed, of course, a particular category level of funding to enable us to do that. This was a submission that we'd have developed to start that process off. In October, Jan Thomas, Richard Trigg and myself, we went to Canberra and met with the federal minister.
And they said, no, you can't get in, we're never going to get in. But I was lucky because my sister at the time was working in the federal government, so we snuck in through the back door. We made a meeting with Kim Beazley and, you know, I think we shocked him. We got back to Bendigo and we thought, well, that was terrific, we think we're okay. And he sent us a letter through to say that we had Category 3 funding, which was exactly the same funding we had. That was the only time when I thought to myself, this is dead. This is dead in the water. We're never, ever going to change this.
We were determined that we needed Level 6 funding. I worked with Tony Schumach and we put together the financial modelling. We worked and we worked and we worked until we got a model that showed that we would qualify for Level 6 funding. The hardest part was then getting the government to agree with us.
Letter after letter, and I think we probably sent two letters a day for 2 weeks to get the funding changed. And at one stage, my sister rang me and said, you've got to cut it out, and the minister's getting really cross with you and he wants you to stop annoying him. And I said, and what did you say? And she said, she won't. And then he came into her office one day and said, tell your sister I've given them Category 6 and to stop faxing me and writing me letters. And I heard this horrendous scream coming from what was then the staff room in Girton House. And then they all came running up with the facts that said Kim Beazley, the Honourable Kim Beazley, has now given you Category 6. From that day on, it was a goer. So then we just called all the parents. We told the staff they had jobs.
There was a knock on the door. And there was Jan Thomas when I opened the door. And she threw her arms around me and she said, we got it. The fees for the new school could be halved. This was going to work.
43-year-old Clayton Jones takes up his post as headmaster at the new Girton Grammar School on December 1st. The former senior master at Sydney's largest co-educational grammar, Skeggs Redlands, is confident students will make a positive transition from the Kennington site to the modest Mackenzie Street campus, which the school first occupied 7 years ago.
It's very clear to me that we can build a very, very good school here. The facilities, the buildings and so on are generally in excellent condition other than they'll need, at the moment, a lick of paint.
Mr Jones says he's impressed by the solidarity of parents who fought to establish a new school to replace the debt-ridden Kennington campus, which will be shut down by the Anglican Church next month.
The plea came from the Friends of Girton to the school, which had been in a similar situation in 1974. So the three founding directors of Skeggs Redlands said, oh, this is history repeating itself, the church can't do this. So they, with Peter Cornish, developed this passion in probably overnight when they heard what had happened. I came down with Peter Cornish to a meeting of the parents. At that meeting, I was completely flabbergasted by the reception that John Higgs received when he stood up in front of the audience and said, now, in a few moments, I'm going to ask you to stand to see if this school will go ahead. If you do stand, it'll cost you $1,900 and we'll collect it before you leave this evening. And I thought, that won't go well. A moment or two later, the crowd stood up and roared. And they were passionate. They had tears in their eyes. They wanted to be all this to go ahead. And I thought, this is it. This is where I'm in.
He said he was willing. Clayton arrived in November of 92, and we'd just taken over the old campus of Girton. And that then presented a whole range of new issues that we had to work through. And of course, staffing was another.
So it was my job to design how the school is going to operate and recruit the staff. One of the first was Dennis Garoni, an inspired junior school appointee.
They put an ad in the Age for staff. And I was at a point in my career, I was working at Brighton Grammar in Melbourne. My wife was 8 months pregnant when the ad came in. I said to her, it'd be good if that ad came up in another year's time. And the next morning she said, there's no point, no time like the present. So I put the application in, said that they probably need a head of junior school, and they contacted me and said, yes, we do. So we came here January the 8th, 93, and hit the deck running.
He and I together built up the junior school staff, and then Robin McCulloch, Tony Schumach and I built up the senior school staff.
I've introduced myself to Chris Morey, introduced Lynette and the baby who was 6 weeks old, and he handed me a paintbrush. Said, off you go. So for the next 2 weeks, we painted, carpeted. There was a hell of a lot of work to do. And I had to interview my staff for the junior school. It's a rare opportunity to actually be able to appoint staff from scratch for a school. Normally you inherit the staff when you take on a role of leadership. This is the emotional part, but wonderful stuff. Friends to this day.
So I just started at the school that year, teaching year three, when it was confirmed that the school would be closing. And I actually was called in for an interview. It was quite surreal to sit amongst all these amazing people who were getting the school off and running. And they said to me at the end of the interview, so what are you doing now? And I said, oh, well, I'm going to go for a wander around the street. And then I'm getting married at 4:30. And the day after, I got a phone call from Clayton to say that I'd gotten the job. So it was still so surreal, but it was really exciting, really exciting.
Mr. Jones will oversee a curriculum shake-up, introducing compulsory Japanese and French and concentrating on a liberal but academic and pastoral education.
Many of the best traditions, I hope, will be continued at the new Girton. There will be changes, of course, because there'll be changes in personality.
And I certainly wasn't afraid to say, if this is what the standard we're setting, that's the standard we set. My vision for a good school is that it must have music, drama, performing arts. All of those things then build a school spirit where it becomes okay to get absolutely involved in everything.
The appointment of Clayton was inspired. He had really clear goals and ideals. We're doing it our way. He's the Leviathan on which the place was built.
He was absolutely brilliant, just exactly what the school needed to get a new formation, new set of rules, a new philosophy up and running.
Made possible by dedication, discipline, hard work and a will to succeed. So, what will we be teaching in 1993? Dedication, discipline, hard work and a will to succeed. By the way, this is the Year 6 classroom.
Girton Grammar, quality.
The busy job then for the 2 months of December and January was to keep up with the friends who were doing all of this, and then to get the whole set of policies, timetables, etc., etc. I had terrific help from Tony Schumach on things like buses, on computers, making sure we at least a nascent IT system. And then Robin McCulloch did a lot of the curriculum work. But we had 2 months.
We had parents coming to see the school that we were promising that we would open for their kids. And there were two rows of classrooms, and we'd done one up to look like a classroom. And that's it, one classroom to convince parents who were going to enrol their children that this would be a good idea.
We had barely a few thousand dollars in our bank account. We didn't know how we'd equip the library. You know, library books are incredibly expensive. Ben Girton College, or the liquidators, were auctioning off the furniture and fittings of the campus. So we thought, right, we need to go and buy what we can. Tony Schumack and I arrived at the auction. People rushed up to us and said, are you here to buy stuff for the new Girton Grammar? What do you want? And we said, we need the library books. And they said, right, you need them more than us. We're not bidding against you. And so we successfully bought the library books.
And all of that was brought in convoys. This big truck driven by one of the Year 12 boys who'd turned 18, backing up from the school gates into the bottom of the ramp that led up to the library. Maybe 50, 60 people just passing books all the way up till finally they went on a shelf. Even chairs, we didn't have any chairs for the classrooms, and Bendigo Senior Secondary College very, very kindly and generously lent us 300 chairs so that we could start the school with children on seats. All of this was done over that summer break so that day one, the school could be as pristine as one could possibly imagine.
The gods appeared to be smiling on Bendigo's newest independent school this morning. The sun was shining for the first morning assembly, a formal celebration to consider the future and remember the challenges of the recent past.
House captains Frew and Johnson.
It felt a little bit odd, with some familiar aspects in terms of the uniform, the school song, part of the name, and a lot of familiar faces. It was new for everybody, but just trying to, you know, keep it positive and feel normal.
The grounds outside were really basic. Yeah.
Pretty basic.
Very basic.
We didn't care.
No, we didn't care. So it was very different to the campus we'd just come from.
We as a community were united and never wavered from our vision of providing for our city and our region, for our children.
Tribute was paid to the many people who gave their time and money, as well as battled the red tape to get the new school up and running in just 174 days.
Here it was beginning to happen. 302 boys and girls with 30 or so staff, many parents, just such a lovely feeling. But
we barely had enough resources to, you know, deliver the classes, but we did. You know, there were still crumbling bricks on some of the walls, you know, paint missing, but no one cared.
Whatever happens tomorrow happens, but today we're just going to be as good as we can be.
But there was still such a lot to be done. You know, there was still so much to be done that I don't know whether there was an enormous amount of time to just stop and celebrate.
I think we were exhausted by the time those first days of actually having the kids walking in. We were running from the early years right through to year 12, and the staff resources were so stretched that effectively every teacher was asked to run an additional class than what would have been normally expected. We of course were there for the kids, and we really needed to make sure that we had a quality education.
What we were selling and what we were promoting and asking parents to support was a strong education, a strong pastoral care system, a continuing involvement with many of the great traditions of Girton College that would continue on at Girton Grammar. And it was selling the concept of collegiality, staff and students together, students with each other, parents with the school. And I think once that realisation hit, the buildings as they were and the facilities faded into the background with the much higher moral purpose of what a school really is. I think the diocese had a lot of trouble coming to terms with the fact that the school had been created, and they were very keen that we would never ever really draw upon Girton College, that we would stand apart as a brand new school, that there could be no real relationship. But one person stands out remarkably, and that is Archdeacon John Gildart, who came even before the school day, the very first one started, came to see Mr. Jones, and he said,
I'd like to help. How can I help?
I would like to stand up and be the chaplain for Girton Grammar School.
A minute later, we shook hands and that was it. So I'm a great fan of John's.
And I don't think that was an easy decision for him to make. He was exemplary. He was Christ in action.
We are here because
of a death and a birth.
There wasn't all that good relationship between the church and the new Girton. So I felt as if I was in a sandwich between the two. I wasn't so much interested in the overall situation. I was there to support the children. That basically was my involvement as to how I became involved with Girton, Girton Grammar.
The name of Girton lives on, but it is a completely new Girton, able to give expression to itself by every means at its disposal. Girton Grammar School is alive, and today we celebrate its life, and together we should shout, long live Girton.
One of the great strengths of our group was we had this group who had an amazing set of skills.
None of us ever had any disagreements. We just had obstacles along the way that we needed to solve, and we had so much talent in that group that we found ways to solve them.
And while the new school starts its life on the original Girton College campus, the school board is confident it won't be long before it's forced to hunt for larger premises.
We were much more successful quickly than I anticipated we would be.
It never surprised me that the numbers grew because Bendigo needed Girton.
We had waiting lists, we had people wanting to come to the school and we couldn't accommodate them. Space was a real issue. We needed to actually physically build buildings to accommodate that growth. Finances are always an issue. We couldn't expand the school and have the parents pay for it. We had to find a way. We needed to accommodate specialist buildings, specialist facilities, and the new builds allowed us to provide what ultimately became the senior school. Then going back and reconfiguring the old campus into a fully-fledged junior school was a great outcome, and it took a lot of time and a lot of effort to get that across the line. The gymnasium is built on public land, and it's allowed Girton to use those facilities but at the same time share them and, you know, be a real member of the Bendigo community.
It's crucially important to have an independent school like this in Bendigo. The Girton of the future I see as a place of great energy. It will be progressive, but also holding dear those traditions passed on to us from our founders. We couldn't be more grateful and able to honour that legacy in the best way we can.
I still see the names on the buildings of parents in different fields, different specialities that band together and somehow created a school with a syllabus, principals, teachers, students, grounds. It was an amazing achievement. I've been trying to explain to my kids those names are actually the ones involved in forming the school.
You don't want to be empirical. You're not trying to create a dynasty or an empire. We're just trying to create a good bloody school. My favourite kids are the ones that had a come to school with a ball under one arm and a violin under the other and a bag of books and have a crack at everything.
Everyone paid for that much. It was astounding. So that passion needs to stay.
I was happy to put everything on the line, but my payback is tenfold when you've got so many other rich, rewarding things like a well-rounded and supportive education that Girton provided.
We'd achieved the impossible. So many people had said it could not happen. To be able to look back at and see how it's developed has given me the much satisfaction as anything I've done in my life. I'm extremely proud to have been one of the founders of Girton Grammar School.
Bendigo needed Girton, Bendigo still needs Girton. It's really back to where it rightly should have been.
I'm incredibly proud of the contribution the school has made to the wider community. I get enormous feeling when I see a student wearing the Girton uniform. And I think, well, if all of us hadn't worked so hard, I wouldn't be seeing that student. That is something that really reminds me of why we did what we did. And I bet the school will continue to make an incredible contribution to this community and indeed the nation.
They talk about a phoenix rising out of the ashes. Well, this one did rise, but it rose very, very quickly. It had over 500 students 2 years later. It is a school that has an extraordinarily strong reputation for academic strength, but also for the quality of the students, and that's what I like most, the fact that we are a community. The staff together are a community, the staff with the students are a community, and our parents are very supportive. That's what a school is. It is a community, it has a heart, and that's what I'm really proud that the heart of Girton Grammar is still beating so strongly today.